tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Mark Daniel, and I'm Alamance County Extension Director and Horticulture Agent, and this morning we're going to talk about lawn care. A lot of publications, handouts over there on the table that you need to have for future reference. So I'm just going to hit the high points. If we really went into lawn care, we'd be here for 3 hours. And I don't feel like doing that, so we'll do an hour and talk about the handouts, and you can have any kind of questions you want. So the first thing you have to start with is getting my remote to work. We'll try one more time on that. Okay, so what you have to think about is your site. And so what is the percentage of sun and shade? If you have got more than 50% shade, you probably can't have good grass. No matter what the advertisements tell you about shade, grass, and this and that, that's not true. You've got to have sunshine to grow grass. There are some grasses that are more tolerant of shade than others. If you have a lot of shade, you probably just not going to have grass. You may have areas where weeds won't even grow. If you can't get a weed to grow, you probably won't have grass. That's going to be a natural area almost certainly. Soil pH, we'll talk about that, how important that is for good grass growth. Pest resistance, drought tolerance is a big thing for us. So we had a lot of rain in May, and then it quit. So basically June, July, we had no rain. And so I had a pretty good yard this spring, but up until 2 weeks ago, it was mostly dead.
Do you water?
Well, I haven't, but starting last week, I started putting an irrigation system in the yard because my wife was not happy about dead grass. And as soon as the man came and started digging ditches, it started raining. So we had some 9 inches of rain in the past week while they're trying to put an irrigation system. Maintenance, and how much maintenance do you want to do? How much time do you want to spend out in the yard? I mean, you can have a golf course quality yard. It's going to cost you a lot of money. It's going to be a lot of work. You know, what do you want to have? And quality ties into that. So you can have a fine yard, it's just going to cost you. Okay, so we'll start with Harry's Lawn Care, inside secrets. There are no secrets to good lawn care. I can tell you how to grow a good lawn. That's not a problem, though. There aren't really any secrets. What we'll start with is a soil. So most of us have a red clay soil here. That's not bad. If you know how to work with it, you can work with the red clay soil and have a very nice lawn, but you have to know how to work with it. The problem starts here during construction is they run the equipment over the soil when it's wet and they compact it. So that's the biggest problem with the red clay soil is compaction. So once you've compacted that soil, the roots can't get established. You're just not going to have good grass. And it's very hard to break this compaction up. You've got a couple of choices, but if you don't have good root growth, you won't have good top growth, and that's just the way it is. So you've got a compacted soil here, then you won't have good top growth. No matter what you do, if you've got good root growth, good loose soil, then you can have good top growth. So you can start with a core aerator. That's what most people use. It takes plugs out of the yard, helps loosen the soil up, and that works pretty well. A lot of our landscapers now are going to this thing called an aerator. So the core aerator works when you've got some moisture in the soil. In September, normally the ground is dry and hard, and that machine there will just bounce across the top of the ground. It won't do any good at all. So a lot of our landscapers now are going to the aerator because that actually works best when the ground's dry and hard. So it has these solid tines, and it's PTO driven, and so when the PTO is on, those tines go down into the soil and they vibrate and they fracture the soil. So you can sort of see here where the soil is all torn up, and where the PTO is turned off, there's very little disturbance at all. So that thing shakes and shatters the soil, makes a really good seed bed, helps loosen up that compaction. So this is more common than the core aerator.
What is PTO?
PTO is a power takeoff, so it's driven by the tractor. And a lot of them will have them on those front mount lawnmowers too, but it's a driven machine where the core aerator, it just rolls. We're going toward this a lot more. The best method is going to be somebody till it up. Of course, that's going to be very expensive to have guys come through there and tear the yard all the way up. That's the best way to do it because you get more loose soil, better root penetration, but it's going to cost you. So it depends on how much money you want to spend in order to have a good yard. Yes, ma'am.
Haven't you done that in your fescue?
Yes.
It looks really good, but it still dies without irrigation.
Yes. So that's the bottom line, that fescue is going to do great September through about May. And as we get into June, hot, dry, and pretty much the bottom line is, if you don't have irrigation or some way to water it over June, July, you're going to lose half a yard almost every year.
Even with doing this?
Even with doing this, yes, absolutely. Unfortunately. Okay. Real quick, and I've got some soil sample boxes back there, and I would encourage you to take soil samples in your yard so you'll know what the yard needs. So basically between pH of 6 or 6.5 is what we're shooting for to get the nutrients available for the grass to grow. And the lime is what we use to neutralize that pH. And you can see here at the low pHs how poor root growth we have, and of course without good roots you're just not going to have a good stand. So that's certainly an important thing to do, is get that line in there. You can apply it as powder or pellet. Only use powder if you're going to till it in. You don't want to till in a pellet line, and the maximum amount is 50 pounds at one time. So you may have a pH in your soil that could be down say 5.5, and you may need 100 pounds of lime, which you wouldn't want to put down to 50 pounds at a time. It's not very soluble, doesn't move to the soil very quickly. So you put down 50 pounds in September, you could come back in January, February, and add 50 more if you need it, whatever the soil test tells you.
I don't understand.
Sure.
Okay, you said lime neutralizes the pH.
Right.
So wouldn't it be bad to have a higher pH? That's when you would neutralize it, not when it's low.
We're neutralizing the acidity. So not, the pH could be high or low, but we're concerned mostly about raising the pH up. So typically our soils are very acidic and not basic. Okay. Where the lime's going to bring up pH up.
Okay?
Right. So it's rare. There are some cases where people will have a higher pH and need to bring it back down, but almost always it's going to be a low pH to be brought up. Okay. You have to be careful when you're buying products. Here's a product here. It's called Solulime. It's telling us that one 50-pound bag is as effective as 5 40-pound bags of pelletized lime. And I like to read the label. And I know when you go to the grocery store, everybody reads the label looking for calories or whatever you look for there. I'm not concerned about that too much, but I do want to read the labels on my lime fertilizer, see what it says. When you go to read the label, it takes 1,980 pounds of this to equal a ton of standard lime. I'm not a math genius, but it seems like to me that's about the same. So I don't see where they can claim one bag is as good as 540 pounds when basically it's the same. So you need to read the label and take this under consideration. Some of this that you see may not be exactly true. Yeah.
Well, 1 ton is 2,000 pounds, so it's like 1980.
Pretty close. 2,000
pounds.
Right. Pretty close. So I'm not exactly sure where they're getting this effectiveness, because it basically is the same. Anyway, read the label. They also have this fast-acting lime that you'll see at stores, and people buy this fairly often. And what they're seeing this year, this is a finer ground material, so that's where it becomes more fast acting, is because it's a smaller particle size, and so it would react faster in the soil. But the problem is that, you know, 2,000 pounds of this equals one ton of lime. So it's the same, really, as a regular pellet lime, except you're going to pay a big price for this. I forget now, this is like $15 a bag or something. It may react a little bit faster in the soil, but I don't think it's worth the cost of buying this product. Because even if you have a low pH, it's going to come up if you add lime. It may take it a month or two longer to use regular pellet lime, but you're still going to get there. Okay, so I say just use regular pelletized lime. That's going to be, I don't know what it costs anymore, $5 a bag or something. Certainly cheaper than the fast acting lime. It's and this is good here. So 1,800 pounds of this equals a ton of standard lime. So that's actually better than what you would get normally. Okay. Questions about lime?
Like, what kind of area are you talking with a ton of lime? I mean,
so it depends on what the soil test says. So sometimes it'll come back and it'll say you need 10 pounds per 1,000 square feet, or you might need 100 pounds per 1,000 square feet. It just depends on the soil test.
But a ton would be ridiculous.
Right. So what they're really showing there is they're just showing the equivalent of this product to a standard ton. So this actually is more effective than the standard lime because it takes less to be equal. Okay. All right. So then we'll start on a fertilizer. So we know you have to have lime if you've got a low pH to get the pH up to neutralize acidity. And we know that just plain old cheapest lime you can buy is probably going to be as good or better as some of these fancy limes. Same thing holds true with fertilizer. Lots of advertisements of all different kinds of fertilizers out there. You just need to know that when it says 10, 10, 10, that means that that bag is 10% nitrogen, 10% phosphorus, 10% potassium, which means 70% of that bag is just filler. That's going to be sand or lime or whatever, it doesn't matter. But you have to understand what those numbers represent. And then the problem becomes when you go to some of the stores and they're just dozens and dozens of different fertilizers there. It's very confusing trying to pick out, you know, which one you really should get. And then you've got all of these different products out there, the Scott's four-step system. It just goes on and on and on. And it's really confusing to know what you need. So the soil test is going to tell you that, but you've got Southern Turf Builder and Super Winterizer. What I'm telling you is the picture and the name don't make any difference at all. You look at the analysis, so you've got a 26-2-13, 24-3-12. They're the same. Within a point or two, it's the same. There's no reason to buy Turf Builder in September and Winterizer in January to the grass. It's all the same, and there are some cases where this actually isn't what you need depending on what the soil test tells you. We'll get to that in just a little bit. Get that right now. So this is a soil report here, and basically what it's going to tell you is it's going to give you the pH here, 6. You don't need any lime because that pH is within the range. Here, 6.5, no lime. So we're good on pH on these samples here. As you get into the fertilizer recommendation, you see that it's 5 pounds of 21-0-0. So in that sample there, you only need nitrogen. So what they're telling you is that the phosphorus index, potassium index are adequate. They're above 50. You've probably used a 10-10-10 in the past. Those nutrients are adequate in the soil. You don't need to apply them. So a straight nitrogen fertilizer is all you would need to get good growth in your grass. As you get down to the second sample, that's going to be 7 pounds of 15-0-14. So you've got adequate phosphorus, but But your potassium, the last number is a little low, so they want some potassium in there. Now, the 15-0-14 is going to be very hard to find. In that situation, I still would probably use a 10-10-10 fertilizer. You're getting a little extra phosphorus there, but that's okay. It's not going to be a real high number, and that will save you from trying to find this 15-0-14 fertilizer, which is not common, hard to find, probably going to be expensive. So 10-10-10 is okay there. So as you're taking your soil samples, when the report comes back, if you have a question, you can call me or email me, and I can look at it online and sort of help you through, because sometimes they'll give you some recommendations of stuff that's hard to find. Or they might have, on some situations I've seen, 3 and 4 different fertilizers on the same yard. You don't want to have to do that. If you can, try to minimize the number of different products you have to buy. I can help with that.
Can I?
Sure.
Does the grass leach the nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium over time?
Yes.
So then you just have to do it?
Right. So
how often?
So the nitrogen moves very quickly in the soil, and it moves very quickly, take it up by plants very quickly. So nitrogen, we're going to apply that probably at least 3 times a year. Phosphorus is fairly stable in the soil. So once you get an adequate phosphorus level, it may stay that way for 2-3 years. Not a problem. Potassium, not quite as mobile as nitrogen, but still will go away. So potassium, you may have to apply once a year, maybe every other year, depending on what the level is. So nitrogen goes away very fast. Potassium is next. Phosphorus is last, but it stays in the soil. Yes, ma'am.
I was just going to ask about the nitrogen. It's got phosphorus and potassium over there, but it doesn't have a chart graph for nitrogen.
Right, they don't measure that. It's so mobile in the soil and in plants that they don't even measure it. So they're what their assumption is, you always, almost always, you're going to have nitrogen for a long.
But it doesn't say how much necessarily.
Well, yeah, so the set where it goes, okay. You know, 5 pounds of that 21-0-0. And so that's based on 1 pound of actual nitrogen per 1,000 square feet. So the rate would depend on what the percentage is. So 5 pounds of 21-0-0 is 1 pound nitrogen. The 7 pounds of 15-0-14 is still 1 pound of nitrogen per 1,000 square feet. So depending on what the ratio is, will be the amount you need.
So
we'll look at that.
On the second example, you would use 10 pounds of 10-10-10.
Right.
Right. To get the 1 pound of actual
nitrogen. Right. I think I may have that. Possible. So one good thing about this is if you have got a recommendation that's like that 21-0-0, you could use this 34% product, and that's going to cost you about 82 cents a pound for the nitrogen. If you use a 10-10-10 fertilizer, it's going to cost you $26 basically to fertilize 10,000 square feet, where a straight nitrogen fertilizer may only cost you $8. So you're not adding nutrients you don't need, and you're also saving money. So that's one other good reason to take a soil sample, is to find out what you actually need. So if you don't need that phosphorus and potassium, you can save some money. Question about that? And a soil sample is going to tell you all this. That's really sort of the bottom line here. Soil test is free. The really only thing it's going to cost you is the postage to mail the boxes down to Rocky. So you can leave them here if you wanted to, and we'll take them whenever we go, but that may be weeks. So I'd say this time of year, if you want to get a sample in time to do something in September for your yard, I'd go ahead and take the sample and mail it to Rocky. And turnaround time now is probably 2 weeks at the lab. So the sooner you got it down there, the sooner you get your results. That'll tell you what you need. You know, is there phosphorus there, is there potassium there, do you need to apply those or not? So the recommendation is going to be add this 1 pound of nitrogen, whatever else. So basically it's going to be September, November, February. That's kind of your rule of thumb there. You would fertilize 3 times, depending on the weather. So there are times where it's hot, dry, you may not do overseeding the fertilization until 1st of October. If that's the case, then you just go October, December, March. Usually March the 15th is your cutoff time. You don't want to be fertilizing tall fescue after the middle of March. Now, lots of different sources here, so ammonium nitrate, ammonium sulfate, all these different straight nitrogen sources, and they're fairly commonly available if that's what soil board tells you.
Is one more considerably more expensive than the other?
I don't know that. Probably not per pound of nitrogen. They're probably pretty close to the same. You know, the advantage in using something like a 34% is you don't have to spread as much. So the rate on that would be like 3 pounds per 1,000 square feet versus calcium nitrate, that's going to be like 7 pounds per 1,000. It's applied twice as much. But that's not a huge deal, but it is a little bit easier. I have to spread so much. So we talk about fertilizer rate. So everything is based on that 1 pound of actual nitrogen per 1,000 square feet. So if we divide 100 by the nitrogen percentage, that gives us our rate. So this is a little bit confusing, but a 10-10-10, the rate there is going to be 10 pounds per 1,000. A 777, 6 pounds per 1,000. 23.5 pounds. So you just take that, whatever the percentage is of nitrogen in the product, and divide that into 100, and that will give you the rate. So no matter what the rate is, no matter what the percentage is, you're always going back to that 1 pound of actual nitrogen per 1,000 square feet. Now, sometimes a bag will tell you this bag will cover 5,000 square feet or some number like that. That may or may not be the case. You may still want to do the math to make sure that what they're saying on the bag relates back to a 1 pound of nitrogen per 1,000 square feet.
If you don't add enough nitrogen, does that mean it's like whatever you've added is nothing, or does it really help the grass at all?
It really helps
the
grass.
Even a little bit.
Even a little bit. Yes. Other questions about the rates? Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I only have a question about the rates, but my lawn care service, which is Integrity, and the guy that owns that said that he was in your class and
yep.
He knows you.
Yep.
Okay, he showed up at my house about 3 weeks ago. And when I saw them out there, I was like, stop, you don't do this in the summer. What are you doing? You know, it was like my grass was dead, it was dry. And so he said that he was putting out something that was like, I guess it was mainly, he cut the thing outside the bag because he knows he's got to do that for me. And he told me to bring it to you, but I didn't do it because Gail was over and I didn't have time to look for it. But anyway, it was mainly nitrogen and maybe some, lime or something, and he said it would help with the dead spots and stuff. But I know what it was. He wanted the $81 in the summer because he doesn't make anything in the summer. And I told him, I said, look, I'm Master Gardener, I've been through March classes, and you're not supposed to put out fertilizer after March. So he knows that. But, you know, I understand, and my grass is really pretty now with this green, with the rain and all, and he did a good job aerating, so I know that if I really annoy him, then I'm going to have him for the rest of my lawn care. So I just gave him his $81, even though I know that it didn't do any good. If anything, it probably hurt it because the grass was so stressed out at that time.
Right. So you may get lucky. Just because it had rain in the past
week,
and had you put that down and you didn't have rain, it may not have been beneficial.
Well, we didn't have rain for like 3 weeks after he put it down, and so it's, you know, but now it's like, well, you know, my grass, I've got sun, and I mean, it's not all fescue, there's like all kinds of yucky stuff in it, but it looks so good, it is so thick. I have the luscious lawn in the neighborhood, you know, after it rains, of course.
Right.
Can I just react, because that's what happened to me. I get told this information, and so I believe it. But when you go on the internet, it tells you you can fertilize in the summer.
No, I know that it's wrong.
But how do you know which is wrong?
Because you listen to what Mark says.
Oh, I see. You choose what you want to believe.
No, this is based on North Carolina State, you know, and all. So this is like, you know, the gospel right here. Those lawn care people are out for the, you know, they have to make money. And they don't make much during the summer because there's not much for them to do.
But you do fertilize warm season.
If it's Bermuda grass, you do it like in, my son lives in Cary, and in his new neighborhood, his Ritzy neighborhood, everybody has to have Bermuda grass.
Right.
So that everybody's yard will be dead at the same time. And so, of course, you know, but we're talking about
fescue, you know, fertilize in the summer, period.
Just curious, why don't we fertilize in the summer? What
season is that? So it's fescue is a cool season grass. And so in summertime, basically, it wants to be dormant. And so by adding the fertilizer in there, you're encouraging it to grow where it doesn't want to. And it stresses the grass, and you can end up with disease problems, primarily brown patch. So if you had an irrigation system, you probably could put some fertilizer on the yard in the summertime at a very low rate, but you may have a disease problem. So the general recommendation is we quit fertilizing cool season grass by the middle of March to avoid pushing it too hard in the summertime.
And isn't most grass mixed? It's not just fescue, it's a combination.
It depends. So if you had a mixed yard where you've got some warm season grasses like crabgrass and Bermuda grass, fertilize sometimes fine. They don't care, they're growing then. Mm-hmm. If you've got tall fescue, then it wouldn't be happy with that. So it depends on the particular situation. Generally speaking, though, we would not recommend fertilizing tall fescue in the summertime because you're encouraging it to grow when it doesn't want to. Okay, question about that? Okay. All right. So the other important thing is if you're going to put the fertilizer out yourself and you know what these rates are, it's all per 1,000 square feet, so you've got to calibrate your spreader. So you can't just go out there and just spread fertilizer randomly. So this room is about 1,000 square feet. So if we're using 10, 10, 10, then I need 10 pounds of 10, 10, 10 to cover this area. So what you do have to do is figure out what 1,000 square feet is. They've got 5,000 square feet here. It doesn't matter. You could lay off an area that's 500 square feet. You're just trying to get the recommended amount of fertilizer on that particular area. So it does take a little bit of time. So if you've got something that's like 10 pounds of 10, 10, 10, you want to put 10 pounds in the fertilizer spreader, set the gate to, you know, kind of a middle reading somewhere, and spread it out over 1,000 square feet. If you run out and you've got it too far open, you've got to close it a little bit. If you have some left over, you open up some more. And if you're on this test area, if you're a little bit high, a little bit low, it's going to be okay. You don't want to dump it all out one place, but as long as you're close, that gives you a chance to calibrate your spreader to where then once you get that done, then you just do the rest of the yard without having to go back and forth and change the setting. So it does take a little bit of time, but it is worthwhile to do so that you get a fairly accurate application. Okay, so here we're in the sort of the transition area, so we're really, it's too hot here for cool season grasses to do well. It's too cold for warm season grasses. If you go down to the coast, that's all going to be Bermuda, centipede, zoysia. They'll do okay here, but they won't brown out in winter time and not be great. So you know, for us, tall fescue is going to give us the most months of green grass. Knowing that you get into June, July, August, it's going to fade away short of having an irrigation system where you can keep it going. So they grow best in the spring and fall. Of course, growth is going to slow in the summertime, and we're looking for soil pH between 6 and 7. So here's your calendar here. It shows where you're going to get a lot of growth in the spring, growth in the fall, and you see the relationship between root growth and shoot growth. So as the grass is growing, you're going to have a deeper root system that's proportional to the top growth. So if you don't have good root growth, you won't have good top growth. They go hand in hand. So what's important with that is that you want to mow this tall fescue as high as you can. So 3.5 or 4 inches is ideal for that. So people tend to like to mow their yard real close. And when you do that with tall fescue, then you're decreasing the amount of roots you've got, you're going to increase the amount of weeds you have. If you don't have good coverage of the soil, weeds will pop up. So cutting tall fescue short is not beneficial. It makes the grass unhappy, it makes the weeds happy. Now, if you've got a warm season lawn like Bermuda, cutting it short, it's fine, that's what they like. The tall fescue does not like being mowed short. Okay. We'll talk about seed a little bit here. So there's things that you'll see, terms. So a blend is what you would use most of the time, and that's going to be two or more cultivars of, say, tall fescue. There's a handout over there that lists all of the recommended varieties. They test this every year and make recommendations of varieties that do well in our area. Then there's a mixture, and this is going to be two or more species, so where they'll have a tall fescue, Kentucky bluegrass mix. So if you've got full sun, a blend will be fine. If you've got some shade in your yard, then a mixture is going to be better. Kentucky bluegrass is more tolerant of shade than tall fescue is. So you could get a mixture, tall fescue, Kentucky bluegrass, and that's going to do better in the shady spots than a straight fescue blend. But there is a handout over there that lists the varieties to look for when you go to buy grass seed. Okay. So we're seeding at 6 to 8 pounds per 1,000 square feet, and that's on a new yard. So if you're overseeding rate's going to be half of that, so 3 or 4 pounds is sufficient. And typically people put out too much seed, and that can be a problem. And again, we're going back to our fertilizing Labor Day, Halloween, Valentine's Day. But there's some little leeway there on that. Okay, seed labels, and we won't spend a lot of time with this. There is a handout there that you could use if you really wanted to go and look at seeds. So it's a seed checklist that will talk about all these different things here. Again, a lot of seed out there is very confusing. You see this advertisement of Grassology. No more weekly mowing, no more fertilizing, no more weeding. If it sounds too good to be true, it's almost certainly too good to be true. You look at the label and you see, well, actually, half of this bag is a Go and Grow coating. So half the bag not even grass seed. Well, the Go and Grow coating it's not really beneficial. And what I do a lot of times is I germinate grass seed on a brick. Bring it in here. People have seen this. I didn't do that this time. But germinate grass seed, no big deal. You can germinate grass seed anywhere you want to, on a brick, on your driveway, whatever. As long as it's got some moisture, it's going to germinate. The important part is having that get established, growing roots into the soil. So it's got some coating here, which helps keep the seed moist, and it'll germinate great. But it's not going to live. It's not going to certainly do any of this stuff at all, unless you've got the soil prepared. You can't just throw this out on top of the ground and hope for the best. It's not going to work. Kentucky 31 is the old standby. Does pretty well. And you can look at the label there, and it talks about seed, crop seed, weed seed, all these things. This is the information you're be looking for to see. Kentucky 31 actually has some pretty good brown patch resistance, but it's a more coarse kind of a pasture grass that people don't really like to look up too much. But it does pretty good, full sun situation. Here's a Kentucky 31 here. The thing to see here is noxious weed seed. So noxious weed seed are weeds that are hard to control. So we've got dock, plantain, sheep sorrel. You don't want this. It's in this bag of seed, so if you go wherever and go buy this bag of grass seed and seed your yard, you have just seeded your yard with weeds, bad weeds. It's legal, it's on the label, so you know what's in there. You just gotta look at that label very carefully and see what that is, but there's seed out there that you actual vine that had these noxious weed seeds in them, and that's bad news. Southern Gold, here's a blend, and I believe all of these were actually on the recommended variety list, so a full sun yard there, that's pretty good. These will change from year to year, and it might change more than once in a year. It depends on seed availability. So they're blending this seed all the time. So at some point in time, in the springtime, you might find this in the fall. They may be out of Endeavor, and they throw something else in there. So you can't really look at the brand name necessarily that may be okay this particular season. The next season, the blend may change. You've always got to look at that label. Yes, sir.
When you say that the germination rate there at 85 is rather low?
It is. Ideally, it would be 90 better, but that's still okay. And that's actually, that's the minimum legal limit in North Carolina, 85%.
Mark?
Yes?
Is there anything about the origin of the seed, you know, where it comes from?
It's almost always going to come from Oregon or Washington State.
Okay, because I noticed that the K31 bag that had noxious weed was from Missouri, and I didn't know whether that.
Yeah, not necessarily.
Yeah.
Typically, it's grown out west because it's dry out there, and they don't have. It's easy to grow the grass and collect the seed out there.
Okay.
They wouldn't. You know, Missouri seed wouldn't necessarily be bad. It's just that it happened to be that seed source. That has a lot of those weed seeds in it.
And why do you put it in? Why do they put noxious weed seeds?
Well, they don't put it in. It's in the field. So when they go out there to harvest the seed, those weeds are out there. So they don't do a good job of keeping the field clean. So they didn't put them in there. They were in the field, and they just sucked up everything that was there. Weeds and all. Okay. So here's a landscaper's. Mixed good for sun and shade areas there. We're talking germination, so germination here is 75%. So that's an illegal seed to sell in North Carolina. Yet I found that in a local store. So still, you always got to be looking. Try not to pay attention too much to the front of the bag. Look at the back of the bag, look at the label and see what it is. Because here, you got some rebel grass seed. It's a pretty good grass seed. I don't know about Brockton, but germination is poor here, so you have to use more seed in order to get a decent stand. Still, that should not be sold. The Rebels, again, good grass seed here, no noxious weed, very little weed seed. That's a decent grass there. It's all Rebel, but see, that's okay. You just want germination 90%. So it's the kind of thing where you just need to look at that label and say, oh yeah, well, that's fine. Nothing wrong with that one at all. Top choice is a white quarrel seed. I like white quarrel seed. They're out of Garner. They use typically a lot of the recommended varieties that have been tested down in NC State in that area. So here you got a Rebel, Honky Tonk, Firecracker, all of those were recommended when this picture was taken. Germination 90%. No other crop seed, no weed seed. This is a really good grass seed here. So inert matter, you got a little bit of dirt in the seed, but that's a real good clean seed there.
Yes. Mark, where can you find all plant seeds like that?
This will be found at independent places like Farm Services, Grain and Feed Seed, Med and Shrubbery, will carry a white quarrel brand. You won't find this in the box stores.
Is it more expensive?
It would be a little bit, yes, probably. But I think it's a better seed than some of the others that are going to have some weed seed content in it. Because the ideal situation is when you go through all this work, you want to have a good yard, you don't want to be planting weed seeds that you've got to control later on. All right, question on seed. So read the label very carefully. Try not to get caught up in the advertisements and the claims that they make about, you know, miracle seed, because it really isn't such a thing. So we're getting pretty close to the time to where we start planting seed. So mid-August, maybe a little early, I'd probably shoot for first part of September, depending on the weather. And there have been cases where first part of September still 90-some degrees and dry, and unless you've got a way to water it, I wouldn't try and sow grass the first part of September. You can go later. So they're saying mid-October. You can seed up until December here and still do pretty good. I would rather seed in December than I would in April, any point in time. Spring seeding on tall fescue down here is something I do not recommend. If we do that all the time, you will see a lot of grass, you'll see it advertised. Spring seeding, you will lose 50% of the seed, the grass, every year, even with irrigation, because it's a cool season grass. So if you plant a cool season grass in April, by the time it gets up and starts getting established, here comes June, hot, dry, and even with water, a lot of it's just going to die. Doesn't like it. Well, I would much rather do my seeding in December, November, December, even January than I would in April. And get that grass started, established, grow some roots before the hot weather comes.
Mark,
yes, ma'am.
If you do aeration in your lawn, do you want to plan that so that you do your grass seed, your fertilizer just as soon after that as you can?
Right. So as soon as you can, now that people are using the aerators, mm-hmm. they can get in a little bit earlier. Because there have been cases where we didn't have rain until 1st of October, and then you're aerating over seeding and thinking. It's okay if you have a full sun yard, but if you have trees, at that point in time then, by the time the grass starts coming up, the leaves start to fall off the trees.
Right.
And then you've got a conflict with that, how to get the leaves up without having to do grass up. So with aerator, you could get in probably the first part of September and get a little head start on the grass before the leaves start to fall. But it becomes tricky to get the right date. Okay, so talking about renovation, so, you know, if you don't have to redo the whole thing, ideally you don't have to, it's just going to try to kill what you got, start over. So lots of different problems you could have with the yard. So I'm doing a renovation of my yard this fall. Mostly dead. I've got some Bermuda grass and some other weeds out there, so I've sprayed the whole thing out with glyphosate, killed it all. So if you've got a situation like this, there's really more weeds than there's grass, you're going to kill it all and then do a renovation. And you want to start early, so don't wait till the 1st of September to do this, because if you have Bermuda grass especially, you won't kill that on the first spray. You want to spray this more than once. So I sprayed 2 weeks ago, mostly dead, but I've still got some spots that are still green. I'll try to spray again this weekend if it doesn't rain, and try to get as good a kill as I can before I start to overseed the first part of September.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
If the temperature is over 90 degrees, is glyphosate even going to work?
So you want to try and spray in the morning.
Okay.
So catch it when it's still in the mid-70s there, so it had a chance to get absorbed. So when it gets over 90 degrees, it may just all volatilize. So as you're spraying, it's evaporating, and then get absorbed. So you want to make sure you don't spray when it's really hot. Yes.
I noticed that when we, and you may touch on this later, and if you are, you can deter that question to later. I noticed that when we talk about weed control, we always talk about spraying and not granular. Is there a reason for that?
Spray is better. So the granular products, they recommend very much like the weed and feed kind of things. So the deal with those is that those granules have to stick onto the leaf surface. And so the leaf has to be wet. Generally speaking, about half of the granules fall off the leaf, so you don't get very good control. Now we'll talk about this more in just a little bit, but you get much, much better control with a spray because you're getting better coverage than you would with granular. It's much easier to apply, but unfortunately, it's just not as effective. I'll talk about that more in just a second. Yeah.
Okay, with the rain, I noticed that in my grass, the weeds are so happy, you know. They're popping up now. And last year, this time of year, I got the weed killer that I hooked onto my hose sprayer because that was easy for me to use. And it did a wonderful job. It just killed the weeds and left, you know, the grass and all. And then by the time he reseeded, you know, it was, you know, all of that taken. I had dead spots and he was, you know, putting new grass there and all.
Right.
And so I'm thinking, oh my gosh, it's time to get that hose sprayer hooked up and start spraying again.
Right, right. And you have to do it a bit careful because some of these things have a waiting period.
Yep, that's right.
So it could be, like 30 days. So if you spray now, then you've got to wait at least until August, September 9th. 30 days for that herbicide to get gone before it could have seen out.
Last year he didn't overseed until probably about the end of November, December, and the grass came up fine. The people that got overseeded early, we had that dry spell and it sat on top of the ground, so it just happened that he waited later, and my weed killer had plenty of time and everything.
Yeah, weather makes a huge difference in how these things how they think grow. Okay.
Can I just ask a question again about your Bermuda grass?
Sure.
So on this chart it says that's one of the grasses for the Piedmont.
Right.
So why are you eliminating it?
Well, if you have a tall fescue yard, and we're primarily talking about tall fescue, then in a tall fescue yard, Bermuda's a wheat.
Oh.
Now you could have a Bermuda grass yard where tall fescue is a wheat. So it depends on what you want. Some Bermuda grass will grow great this time of year, but in October it's going to be brown. Then brown until next May. If you like that, that's fine. And some people do have Bermuda lawns.
And it's green all summer. That's why they recommended, because you have to water it so much. And see, they don't have to water it all, the Bermuda, but it's like it's golf course grass. And actually, Bermuda grass is more expensive too than fescue is.
Right. But it is brown all winter, but then you can come in there and overseed in the wintertime with a rye. And green 12 months out of year, but it is a more expensive procedure because you're dealing with two different types of grass. But it's all what you want. Okay, so renovation, we're trying to get rid of the weeds. We want to apply our lime fertilizer chlor to the soil test report, whatever we need there. They talk about you may not want to put nitrogen down before you put out a new grass. I would disagree with that. I want to have my nitrogen down when I put my seed down, because what happens a lot of times is the yard gets wet once you cut the seed down, and you may not be able to get back on there to put the nitrogen down as the grass is germinating. And I'd rather have it put down first, have it there, so as the grass germinates and it's trying to grow, it's got some nitrogen there, and not worry about trying to come in and put it down after the fact, because you may be late. I'd rather have it down first, because you're gonna put it down at least three times anyway. Yes, ma'am.
Are you going to talk about thatch, removing thatch?
Thatch normally is not an issue with tall fescue.
No.
Mm. Thatch is normally an issue more with warm season grasses. Usually.
Well,
you got thatch?
I had a brand new, everything that you said here, brand new, beautiful lawn in the spring. And then June and July came, and now I've got these brown patches. But what happens is that grass has like burned up and just died on the spot, and it makes mat.
Right, right. Which is not necessarily a problem. So when they come in there and aerate or aerate, whatever it is, that actually helps be like a little mulch. So like instead of putting down wheat straw, that kind of is your mulch to hold moisture in the soil.
Close mowing can help.
Suck that up.
Right before
Yes.
Real close.
Yeah.
Great, thank you.
That's not bad. So when you're putting the seed down, they want to go in opposite directions there, so you just have good coverage, ideally, if you can. You want to make sure the soil's loose. As best you can, you've got to have good loose soil in order to get the roots to grow. So we go back to the core aerating. So it's got to be done when the soil is moist. If the soil is hard and dry, it's just not going to work at all. You've got to make a lot of different passes in order to get that soil loosened up. So there, our machine again, you can sort of see the cores that is pulling up out of the soil. So when the ground is moist, it works very, very well. It'll pull these cores out of the ground. And this is what you get here. So instead of having this compacted soil, you've got these holes where the moisture and nutrients can get into the soil and you get new root growth there, and it makes the grass very happy.
Excuse me, is that a good source for soil test material?
You could. Generally speaking, on the soil test, they want you to go down on 4 inches, and usually those cores aren't quite that deep. But it's okay. I mean, you can still use them. You can still use them if you want to. It'll skew your results a little bit, but I can help you with that. Then there's the aerator. So hard, dry soil aerator works pretty well to shake the soil, give you a pretty good seed bed there. So either one of those are fine. Establishment here, talking about getting the seed down. This is probably too much seed, really. Something like that is better. I mean, each seed could make a clump, because tall fescues are clumped on the grass, so each seed makes a clump like this, so you've got 20 seeds in a 3-inch area. That's really too thick. It's better to go lighter than it is thinner, because most of that seed, when it germinates, is going to get choked out and die. So you don't need to use that much seed there, because if you buy a good seed, it's going to be expensive, so you're wasting some money by putting it out quite so thick.
What was the significance of the key?
Just to give you some schedule. I'm not sure. But that's just, the seed's just too thick. So then once we got our seed down there, it needed to be watered, so the ideal situation is you have some way to water it. So if you put the seed out there and it doesn't rain for 3 weeks, it's not going to germinate, it's just going to sit there. It'll sit there for months, but the sooner you get water on it, the sooner it's going to germinate. So you start off initially watering on a daily basis, lightly, just for a few minutes, because the seed's on top of the ground. Just keep that top inch of the soil moist, and then as the seed germinates and starts to grow and roots penetrate, then you water less frequently, but longer. So you're watering a little bit deeper to help the grass get established. So duration depends on the time, but you start off lightly and frequently, and then less frequently and deeper. Here they've got some catch cans, so you don't really know. You put the sprinkler out there, you probably want to have some catch cans out there just to see how much water you're actually putting down. You want to have enough water to get the grass to germinate, but not so much that it starts to run off down the curb. Okay, so here's my front yard. You see, you know, springtime is great. Then, you know, by August, it's mostly dead and it's time to do renovation. So you reseed and you get something like this. Looks a whole lot better. But it's, again, this is a process to get this. Start off by spraying it all out, making sure all the weeds are dead. Then you come in there and you get it all tilled up there to get the ground good loose so the roots can penetrate. Here's a side yard, same kind of thing, real patchy. Brown patch disease and then just drought gone, redo that, and then have nice green grass, which really looks nice next to the neighbor yard there. But so it's a thing that you can definitely do. Okay. We hit weeds real fast, and crabgrass is probably the most common weed that we have in our yards, and really it's fairly easy to control.
I don't think so. The
crabgrass
is winning.
Ah, okay. We'll talk about that. All right, so the ideal situation here is there are pre-emergent herbicides that you can use, Varicade, Pendulum, a couple of them. Put this down about the 1st of February. Does a pretty good job on controlling this, so this is a comeback from seed. What they do recommend here is this mowing thing is, so if you overseeded in the fall, you got new grass, you need to mow it twice to use Varicade, 4 times if you're using Pendulum, which is not a problem if you're overseeding in September. By the time the 1st of February rolls around, you should have mowed the grass at least that much. But these pre-emergent herbicides work very well to control grass. You may have to go back in there the 1st of May and put out another application for late germinating seed. And there are other herbicides besides these two, these two primary, but work very good for crabgrass control. The problem people have a lot of times is they wait too long to put the herbicide down. They wait till the 1st of April, put it down, and by then, crabgrass probably has already germinated, and then it's too late. So you put the product out, but you missed the window to control it. So get it down early is better. Other thing to think about here too is mowing height. So if you mow your tall fescue at 1 inch, you're gonna have about 80% coverage in crabgrass because the light gets to the soil. If you mow your tall fescue high and have a pretty good stand, you'll have very little crabgrass because there's no light getting to the soil for that seed to germinate. This picture here, you'll see crabgrass. It's right along the edge of the sidewalk, very little in the yard. You've got a pretty good stand tall fescue. It's shaded out in the yard, but right there at the edge of the sidewalk, it's getting some sun and it's able to germinate.
You can take that picture out here where that new patch of fescue is along the brick walk.
Yep.
Same thing, because they edge there, so it becomes an open area.
Yep. Yep. The imitation for crabgrass.
Mm-hmm.
So here we're talking about the granular products here, so the weed and feeds are very common. There's a couple of problems with this. It's okay in February because you're putting out fertilizer then. However, the crabgrass preventer not going to work well at that point in time. But there are some products that you can use. So this is post-emergent. So if you did not get out your crabgrass product or you just got a strip by the sidewalk, there's no need to put out a pre-emergent over the whole entire yard. You can wait till it comes up, then you can spray it out with one of these post-emergent sprays. That works pretty well too. So you've got an option there. If you don't have much crabgrass, you can come back and spray it once it comes up.
Those don't kill the fescue?
They don't kill fescue. So that's selective products. Just to kill the crabgrass and goosegrass, but not hurt fescue. Yes, ma'am.
Can you use those products near flowering plants or? Because there's a lot of crabgrass in our...
You can, you just have to be careful.
Okay.
Right. Because the drift, especially on the trimec, may injure other plants. So with all these things, you have to be very careful about drift and hitting things that you don't want to hit. Okay. If you have Bermuda grass, so there's a whole protocol here about suppressing Bermuda grass in tall fescue, so you wouldn't necessarily have to kill the entire yard. You could go in there and beat that back without killing everything. That's also is a possibility if you had interest in that. So winter annual weeds, it's getting close to that time, so hen, bit, chickweed, we're gonna see those by the end of September almost certainly. While they had the weed and feed products for that, still the rule of thumb is they're not going to work very well because it's got to stick to that leaf. And if it doesn't stick to the leaf, it bounces off on the ground, it's not going to give you good control. The spray is going to be a better way to go in any case. Lots of broadleaf weed killers out there, Trimec, Escalade, Speed Zone, Ortho, Weed Begone. All of these are a combination 2,4-D, dicamba primarily. And you want to start early. So you want to start as soon as you can. So the Trimec got to mow it 3 times, Speed Zone mow it 2 times. Once that tall fescue is established in the fall, you want to go ahead and get on these weeds before they have a chance to get established and start to flower and make more seeds for more weeds.
So Mark, why is it necessary to mow?
So that's just the time period to let the new grass get established. So rather than saying 60 days, someone will say 60 days, they just want that new fescue established, roots established, before you start to spray. If you start to spray these things when the grass is just germinating, you may injure tall fescue.
So Mark, you wouldn't put out a pre-emergent now?
No.
Like if you're going to overseed this fall?
Would not.
Okay.
Right. Because see, then the pre-emergent, most of these are probably good for 60 days.
Yeah.
So then that makes you into the middle of October before it's overseed, except for if you have annual bluegrass. So if you have annual bluegrass, you would use a pre-emergent and wait because that's the only way to control it. So,
Mark,
yes, sir.
Do we have a schedule which would be a yearly schedule, which would indicate on it time to seed, time to spray, time to fertilize, time to lawn.
Yes, so I think I have a tall fescue lawn maintenance calendar.
That's right here.
Over there?
Did you get this?
Right. Which gives you a schedule of when to do what.
This is the lawn maintenance calendar.
And it may also be in that Carolina Lawn publication.
Carolina Lawns?
Right, we have a publication over there. But what I would tell you is that we've done a lot of stuff really fast. And you're probably going to still have questions. So I would say you can call me or email me at any time. For particular questions, but it's impossible to cover all this. I mean, it's a lot to try to remember all these things and all these little particulars. But you know, if you have any bluegrass, you would use pre-emergent this time of year. If you don't, you wouldn't, because that interferes with overseeding. So it's a fairly complicated procedure to go through all that. Oh, that was in there anyway.
So, pretty close to rocket science.
I wouldn't say that. But it's not, you know, you see the advertisement on TV and they say you buy this and you buy that and you've got this lawn that's perfect and never have to weed, mow, or water. That's just not true. You can have a perfect lawn, but it does require some inputs and some and time. It's just not as simple as what they would want you to do. Yes.
What is your email address?
So I have, well, I should have cards. Chris, would you get some of those
bookmarks?
Yeah. So we got bookmarks that have my email address on there. Okay. Chris will go get some of those. But I'm glad to help. But really, I can't cover all the particulars in an hour of time, but I can certainly help you.
Would you rather have an email than a phone call?
No matter. Whatever you want to do. Yes,
ma'am. Okay. Is this class pretty much over?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I want to say something to the Master Gardeners.
Okay.
We have a trip coming up in September to the North Carolina Zoo. And I noticed that our plant sale is on September 19th. And our fabulous trip to the North Carolina Zoo is 1 week after that.
Yes.
So be planning on going. And if you're not a Master Gardener, you guys need to get signed up for the new class that's coming up. But it's going to be fun. We'll go over and we'll look at the plants and all in North America. And then we'll have a fabulous lunch in downtown Asheboro. And I'm working on all the particulars, so you'll soon be getting all the details on that. So go on and put that on your calendar. Last spring, my daughter and my grandchildren, all of them were here. We went to the North Carolina Zoo. The first time I've been since they first opened years ago, and I was just so amazed. That is an amazing place, and we really need to be proud to have that here in North Carolina.
Thank you.
So.
Other question about grass?
Like when we're looking at the grass seed, is there like a shelf life that grass seed gets old and it won't germinate itself? Do you know what I mean? Like aging?
Use about a year.
A year.
The seeds.
Yeah. I have a question. We had our backyard, we had sod put in. I don't know what kind of grass it was, because my husband did that. And I had a friend that's a landscaper, and he said that we have too many oak trees for the grass to survive in there. Is that possible, or can you fertilize so that it doesn't have that kind of effect?
Right, it could be too much shade. So there are cases where no matter what grass you use, it could be too much shade for the growth.
Well, even like we have a patch where there is sun, but around it, I mean, there's not shade where the grass is, but all around it, we have a lot of oak trees. I don't know. He said it does something to the pH. But I was hoping that,
yeah.
And it did. I mean, it considerably went down. Again, I don't know what kind of grass it was, but there's big brown patches everywhere. Like you could see through to the dirt.
Right.
And I thought, well, maybe he's right. But
yeah, so I'd get a soil sample, and that way you can check on pH. The pH you can correct.
Okay.
The shade issue, however, is something you can't do as much about. So, you know, if you had, say, full sun in the middle of the day for 2 or 3 hours, that still may not be sufficient. So if you have shade in the morning and then have a little sun in the middle of the day, the shade in the afternoon, you still may not have enough sun to grow grass. So I say, get a soil sample, you can send me some pictures. I can sort of see what you've got there, and then I can tell you better if it's, we got a chance. Other questions? So anytime you have other follow-up questions, whatever, you can call me, email me, or whatever, and I'd like to help, because it really it is much more difficult than what you would think. Mm-hmm. Thank you.